stay focused, and get the job done. But the history of this event always throws up the unexpected. Very rarely do your top three favourites end up standing on the podium.
Thomas Bach, the president of the IOC, is present at the Kasai Canoe Slalom Centre for this final, the first medal event in the Canoe Slalom programme in Tokyo 2020. It's another beautiful afternoon in Tokyo. A gentle breeze. The breeze was a little bit stronger earlier on, but those poles out on the course fairly static. 25 gates for the paddlers to negotiate. You can see the temperature is 28 degrees, very pleasant, still quite humid in Tokyo, but when the paddlers are on the water, that temperature and that humidity, not hugely important.
No, look, and no wind. Wind can be a factor for these athletes as we do just have a look at this course. So as mentioned, 25 gates in all, and the first back upstream gates are 4 and 5. We saw in the semi-final, as we came down through the rankings, that most paddlers negotiated those reasonably well. It was ironically actually through the middle part of the course that we saw a little bit more chaos and carnage. It requires a huge amount of concentration. They have had an opportunity since the semi-final to go back, do some visualizing, and maybe just make those slight mental adjustments. A lot of time can be made and lost from gates 24 to gates 25 and then through to the finish, because at that point fatigue kicks in.
They go in the order of qualification, so the fastest paddler in the semi-final will go last. That is Martin Thomas of France. And of course there is a French defending champion who isn't here, but Aneda Takuya will be first to go, followed by Matej Benoush, who was one of the favourites.
Well, this is interesting, isn't it? So, Haneda Takuya, he has won a bronze medal previously, so we know that he has the temperament. He won third in Rio back in 2016. First medal for Japan in canoe slalom, the first medal for an Asian athlete as well. He's got a taste of it. Yeah. He's enjoyed the success. He now has to paddle with freedom. He's going to have to take some risks. He's small by stature, which gives them a low center of gravity, but also gives them that greater flexibility.
This is the men's C1 canoe slalom final, the first to go. Aneda Takuya for the home nation of Japan. The eyes of Japan will be on him. As you say, he's been through this course before already in the semi-final, and he's made a positive start, has Aneda, through those first two. Oh, he's had a 2-second penalty on gate number 4 there, which really, for the paddlers, any penalty here is going to be crucial.
Well, they had a look in their semi-final. That semi-finals ran about 45 minutes ago. So, what muscle memory? How much thinking has he done? So far, so good, but slow by what we saw in the semi-finals. 34, 35 seconds was the time they would be hoping to hit if they get themselves in the medals. But is he just playing percentages initially? He says, I believe I can make time up on this back half.
Looked like a touch on that gate anyway. We'll wait to receive confirmation on that. Maybe he just missed it. And Ada just lost a little bit of time there in the backwash there, and he's struggling to get up through that upstream gate. Haneda, still just the 1 2-second penalty so far.
We saw a touch, so the 2-second penalty does come at gate 20, and another one. So he's just lost control of this, and that's the danger when you have to risk things, when you have to say, look, you know, hey, it's a medal or nothing for me. I'm not sure it's going to be the year of the Japanese, unfortunately.
This time doesn't look like it's going to be good enough to get Haneda amongst the medals. 4-second penalty and a time of 109.30, and he'll be disappointed with that. Obviously, huge expectation on him having won a medal in Rio, but I think you can tell from his face that he knows he's not going to pick up another medal here.
No, and that is so much focus on getting yourself into this final. they've done that, and not a big turnaround between the semi-final and the final.
Well, 109 for Haneda is a couple of seconds slower than his semi-final time. And that semi-final time just got him into the final. The poles there, you can see, moving before he even arrived at that gate, making it difficult for the paddlers. Still just a gentle breeze here, but enough on occasion to move the poles as the paddler approaches a gate, and that's always something that they don't like. So the first time is on the board for Haneda, 109.30. Next to go after him will be Matej Benuš from Bratislava in Slovakia. World ranked number 4 paddler.
Well, he's been 9th in the World Championships. Silver medal. So he is an athlete who has a big game temperament. He's going to need every bit of it right now.
Silver medalist in Rio in 2016, Matej Benuš, had his problems in the semi-final, which has resulted in this early start in the final for Benuš. Slovakia, of course, such a powerful nation in this sport down through the years, beautifully through gate 4 there and quickly across to the second upstream gate, gate number 5 for Benuš. And
lost a little bit of time through gate 5. Just fighting a little bit at the moment. Just needs to try and just get a little bit more speed, get on the edges. He's going to have to work hard through the middle sections. Let's have a look at that time, 35.6. Through the semis, it was around that 34-second mark. So he's got some work to do.
Well ahead of Haneda at that first split time, but Haneda's time of 109.30 was a disappointing one, so Benuš knows that he's really got to push it now in this lower part of the course in this C1 final. Again, just fighting with the water there to get across to the next gate. Really having to work hard, punting off the wall there, Benuš. Well up on the second split as well. It's a clean run so far, although he's had a penalty there, Benuš, and that could be costly for him.
Absolutely. A penalty in this top 10, and I think you're out of the medals. You're going to have to be flawless. But that's what pressure does to you. You'll be disappointed with the semi-final. Trying to make it up here in the final. And sometimes you sort of move away from maybe what was the original game plan. And he will be disappointed with that. 105.6.
Yeah, it's a disappointing time for the world fourth ranked paddler, Matej Benuš. And again, you can almost from the body language when you see them after they've crossed the finishing line, you know whether it's been a good run or a disappointing one. And Benuš, his body language said disappointment, because his likelihood of picking up a medal here in Tokyo 2020, well, pretty unlikely at this stage with a time of 105.60. Touch on gate 19 for Benuš. It's a setback for him. And
five years, and it can be so cruel, can't it? Just we're talking about just such small percentages. You know, sometimes it's the difference between a good sleep and a bad night's sleep, and the nerves. And
next to go in this C1 final is Adam Burgess from Great Britain, 29-year-old.
So he's 22nd at the 2019 World Championships, 14th back in 2017, but they did win a silver in the C1 teams event. He is on the cusp of a breakthrough performance. Is it now over the next 100 seconds?
huge minute and a half for Adam Burgess as he looks to try and win a medal for Britain at this canoe slalom. This is the first medal event at the canoe slalom competition in Tokyo 2020 through the two upstream gates there. Okay, he's had a bit of an issue there getting through gate six and just lost a little bit of time. Burgess down into gate seven and onto gate eight, which comes very quickly.
Not so solid from Burgess through that first half, but now this is that key section. Very deceptive indeed.
Marginally up on the time of Benoit at the first split, but again he's having to work really hard there, fighting the water as it rages down at the Kasai Canoe Slalom Centre.
Well, this is a good run. He just cannot now give up a two-second time penalty. He's doing everything right. He's using the hydrodynamics of this course to the best of his ability. So he's got five gates remaining. One more gate back upstream. That comes at gate 24.
Through that gate 24 and the final gate 25, and driving for the line, Adam Burgess looks like he's going to clock the quickest time so far. 103.86. Is that going to be enough to win a medal for Adam Burgess?
Well, you would probably, looking at what we've seen in heats, what we've seen in semi-finals, time-wise, probably not. But he has a number on the board. He's had his run. He now throws the pressure on those paddlers still to come. Do not underestimate the pressure of all or nothing, no mistakes, and what is up for grabs.
It's nice to have a score on the board, isn't it? All right, and it's a very valid point. With the pressure of an Olympic final, what it can do to paddlers, to have a time of 103.86, he's certainly not without a chance of getting a medal with that time.
And how much are they slower because of the fatigue of the semi-final, which was run literally 45 minutes ago? How much energy do these paddlers use in one run over 100 seconds? And so, are they slow simply because they've lost just a little bit of oomph?
Well, we'll see now as Zach Loughlin goes for the USA, the fourth paddler to go in this final from Durango in Colorado, the man they called Bug, Zach Loughlin, looking to medal for the USA.
Yeah, first at the Pan American Games back in 2019.
Well, he was able to handle the pressure in Lima back in 2019 when he took gold there. Can he handle the pressure in an Olympic final in Tokyo 2020? He's away, Zach Loughlin, the 27-year-old. Was impressive in the heats yesterday.
Well, he went a 105.97 in that semi-final. And I think he knew he was better than that. And so, can he find that extra 3 to 4 seconds?
See how physically demanding this is on the paddlers. A reminder that they're kneeling in that boat there.
Yeah, the muscle groups that they are using at times, it will be the lower extremities, a lot of the time clearly in the upper body. Very, very strong through the core. Rolling the dice through that part, but gets away with it. Now he's got to come cross back into the middle here and use that white water and get some good speed. So does that well. This now comes the tricky part, because there's a really strong flow behind him, and then you've literally, in layman's terms, slammed the brake on.
He has a second to spare on that second split, 1.3 seconds indeed, Zach Loughlin. So he has a chance here of posting good time, the American, as he goes through gate 23 towards the last upstream gate.
So we touch possibly. Yes, he did. Picked up the 2 second penalty just when he didn't need it. And a good run, but that 2 seconds is going to be costly for the American.
Yeah, 106.08. He would have posted the second quickest time had he not had that 2 second penalty, but sees him post a time of 106.08, so it's the third fastest time at the moment, but I think he knows that that penalty on gate 24 is going to come back and bite him.
Well, six peddlers to go. They'll be looking at the four that have already gone, and they will be saying, I don't think those times are good enough. But they cannot afford to get ahead of themselves, and I'm sure they won't. But let's not kid ourselves. They are thinking about it. It's only natural to want to see your fellow competitors somewhat fail. It's not about bad sportsmanship. That is just human behaviour at this level. And when it's all said and done, you'll see a wonderful level of camaraderie, won't you?
There it is,
just that little touch, just with the head too. And we're talking just millimetres, aren't we? Look at the sheer volume of water as well.
That's the thing, when you try and take those upstream gates as tight as possible to save as much time as possible, it is a gamble because you do run the risk.
Well, you're using so many different parts of your body just to stay balanced and to be able to basically steer your boat. And then at the same time trying to avoid obstacles.
Next up, Sideris Tasiadis of Germany, the 31-year-old, very experienced paddler. Silver medalist in London in 2012, finished fifth in the final of this event in Rio. So this is his third Olympic Games, and he's looking for his second medal in the C1 event. Lovely flow through the water there, top of the course for Tasiadis. Just ran into a bit of choppy water there as he went into gate number 5, the second of those upstream gates, and lost a bit of momentum as he got through gate 6. A little bit awkward through 6, but he got through it.
Well, this is the key part of this course. It's really, I believe, going to be won through gates 8 through to 16.
Just down on Adam Burgess' time on that first split, but he's close enough to make the time up in the lower part of the course with a good run, Tasiadis.
Really now all or nothing. He's going to just have to lay it down. Great form, great athleticism.
He's
ahead
now.
There you go, he is leading at the moment, so he's arguably on the water, the gold medalist on the water, can use that term. He's still got a number of paddlers to come yet, and he's still got to get through the back part of this course.
Really fighting to get across there to gate 23 and into the last of the upstream gates, 24. He's taken that tight and he's managed to avoid the pole through gate 25. Tasiadis driving towards the line here, the German. Sideris Tasiadis, 103.70, puts him ahead by 16 hundredths of a second.
And he is thrilled. So what does he know about this course? What does he understand about the fatigue levels that all of these athletes are under, having come off a semi-final, for an athlete of his caliber to show that level of emotion?
And you could see the face of Adam Burgess afterwards, a face of disappointment, knowing that his gold medal position was gone. He's currently sitting in the silver medal position, but of course there are still 5 paddlers to go, and 5 very, very talented paddlers still to go. But at the moment, it is Tasiadis who is in front. 103.70, the key time. That is the time to aim for these paddlers if they're going to win a gold medal at these games.
Okay, so is 103 the benchmark? He suggests it just might be. And what a way to cool off too. just giving you an idea of just how warm it is. There's a bit of a breeze coming across the course, so as they're coming down the course, it'll be coming across their left. In fact, just looking at the flags here, coming across their left shoulder. So 103.7. Five more paddlers.
Halfway through this final, Tasiadis, Burgess, Benoush at the moment in the medal positions, but as you say, five top paddlers still to come. So I think we have a dramatic few minutes ahead of us at the Kasai Canoe Slalom Centre.
Just look at that position there. Great technique, great form.
Pictures there of the first five paddlers down. That's the way the medal podium would look if the event were to finish.
Interesting now. Just to see a little bit of writing on the hands of some of the paddlers too. Now there might be splits in terms of what they're trying to achieve at certain points on the course. Look, could just be simple little reminders of why they're there and just some key phrases just to remind themselves. Really easy to lose a bit of that clarity when you're in the start gate.
This is Benjamin Savsek of Slovenia. He finished sixth in Rio. He finished eighth in London in 2012. He'll be hoping to go one better, or a few better maybe, than those finishing positions in Tokyo. Savsek, he's 34 years of age now, so again, he's got vast experience, and he'll be hoping to use that experience in this final run in the C1 event. Benjamin Savsek from Ljubljana in Slovenia. He's a former world champion from 2017 in Po, so he knows about what's required to get to the top of the podium.
He just loses a little bit of the control here. That could be costly. Boy, now, where does the thinking go? Does he have to maintain composure, or does he have to just paddle with zero caution? 1.73 seconds, and he lost it in those early gates. Wow, that is a big surprise.
I think he's up 1.7 seconds. I think he's managed to make time there somehow, because he was having to really fight with the water to get through those opening gates. But for Savsek, it'll be interesting to see how he fares in this middle part of the course, the part that you described as such a tricky one for the paddlers.
We've been very good through 16, 17 and 18. And this is this really
good,
tough, where speed is important, but speed can also be your enemy. We'll have a look where he is at three quarters.
If he can keep this clean until the end, without incurring any penalties, I think Benjamin Savsek could be a real contender here. Just the last gate to get through for Savsek, and this is going to be the quickest time by far so far for the Slovenian. It's 98.25. Savsek, what a time, 5.5 seconds almost, quicker than anybody else. Will that be the gold medal winning performance?
That has psychologically sent, I think, just a little bit of damage through the minds of the four paddlers that are still to come. That was incredible. 6 through 15. He just got it right. He just picked every aspect of this flowing man-made river. And that might just be a gold medal winning performance.
It's going to be a really hard time to beat, that's for sure. It's going to take an unbelievably special performance to beat 98.25. So at the moment it's Savsek, Tasiadis and Burgess who are in the medal positions with four paddlers still to go, but that reaction says it all, doesn't it? Well, Savsek, he had disappointment in London with that eighth place finish. Disappointment in Rio when he finished outside the medals. Could it be third time lucky for him?
Well, that changes the game here big time. It depends, though. Are they happy with just a medal or are they here to win gold? That also will play a big factor for these remaining four paddlers.
This is Lukas Rohan from the Czech Republic, having to go after such a fast time just before you. I wonder psychologically, does that have an effect? As you say, Rohan really needs to push it here to try and challenge 98.25. It's a really tough target to hit.
He has been aggressive, he's got no choice. Picked up a 2 second time penalty. And I'd hate to say it at the top of this course, but we are gonna come down to, I think, seconds. That early on, and that is the danger. That is the danger of pressure, chasing it this hard, this early. He's off the pace.
Again, psychologically, when you incur a penalty so early in your final run, it must have an effect for Rohan here. It's going to be virtually impossible to make up that time, but he still might have medal potential if he can keep it clean between now and the end of this run. So he needs to keep pushing, keep driving, even if it isn't going to be a gold medal. There might be a silver or a bronze on the cards.
Well, the athletes that have still got to go, they're dealing with the same pressure. They're dealing with the same expectation. So he wants to still put a really good number on the board. He's pulled some time back here. This is still a very good run from what we've seen so far. He's got to come through 23. He's got one more gate that he has to go back upstream. Here it is. Nicely done. Now get himself back into the river, into the middle. Use that current. Let's see what that time is.
Well, it's 101.96, and that puts him into second position at the moment for Rohan. Puts him into the silver medal position, and again he's celebrating. He knows it gives him a chance of a medal at least. If he hadn't had that 2 second penalty, he'd still be second, but he'd be in a better position in terms of maintaining that second position with the other paddlers to come.
And this is experience here, isn't it? You pick up that early 2 second penalty, it's got to just suddenly register, but he just put it to one side. In fact, it motivated him even more. Wonderful, wonderful run from him.
So we have Slovenia's Benjamin Savcek in the lead at the moment. Lukas Rohan of the Czech Republic second. Sideris Tasiadis of Germany in the bronze medal position with three paddlers still to go. But Rohan again, he was celebrating after this run because having incurred that 2 second penalty so early on at gate number four, he recovered really well. There is that celebration. He's happy. That's a happy celebration.
Yeah, it is. It is. I mean, he pulled something out of the bag there, literally. That is a very good number in a final situation. It's incredible, isn't it? And we are just talking seconds here. You know, it's an old cliche. You often hear it in sport. It comes down to less than 0.01%, that elusive 1% in performance. Well, this is a metaphor for it, isn't it? I mean, 1% can be the difference.
Now, Ander Elosegui of Spain, from the Basque region of Spain. Twice he's finished fourth in the Olympic Games in Beijing and in London. He finished eighth in Rio. This is a big, big moment for him. Can he get an Olympic medal at the fourth time of asking? He's now 33 years of age.
Well, talking to people around the venue, everybody wants to see this man get himself on the podium because it's sort of known in Olympic circles. Arguably the worst place to finish at Olympic Games is fourth. He's done it twice and he's a veteran. Did he pick up a 2 second penalty? He did. So now real pressure goes on him. He's struggling just a little bit. Makes a little correction, beautifully done. Cuts the angle there. So reduces the distance between the gates.
Like Rohan before him, he's incurred that 2 second penalty quite early in his run. Can he recover as the Czech paddler did to post a time that might get him into the medals? He needs to work really hard here, Elisegi, using all his experience.
Just loses a little bit more time there, but recovers well. It's what he can do out of this gate. Good speed. Nicely done. Recovers well.
Yeah, second split time there of Savsek. He's 4.5 seconds down on that. And again, he's lost a bit of time going into that second last upstream gate, gate 19. This is going to be hard work for Elisegi now to get into the medals. Down towards the last gates on this course, 23, and the last upstream gate, gate number 24. He's through that one and through gate number 25, driving for the line, but it's going to be disappointment for Elisegi once more. It's not going to be a medal. He's finished in a time of 106.59. That puts him in seventh position at the moment. He's a consistent performer. He's always in the final at the Olympic Games. But yet again, for Ander Elisegi, he's going to be just outside the medals.
Well, that performance now of Lukas Rohan, who picked up that 2 second penalty, he suddenly is genuinely now in contention for a medal.
Still Savsek, Rohan, and Tasiadis, 1, 2, and 3, with two paddlers still to go. So no matter what happens, Savsek is guaranteed a medal of some colour, but at the moment he's in the gold medal position. That wonderful time of 98.25. Still to come, Dan Watkins from Australia and Martin Thomas of France, the last two paddlers. And this is where we talk about extreme pressure now on these guys.
And this is where we talk about, be careful what you wish for on the semi-finals. Do you want to be second to last? Do you want to be last? Or do you want to, as we sort of talked about during that semi-finals, is the best place maybe to be somewhere in that middle? So you get an idea of some paddlers and what they've done, but then you put a number on the board, you then apply the pressure. So really what they've got to do, and this is where the experience kicks in, they know that they're the only ones that can control the outcome here. They've just got to put themselves in that bubble and do what they do. Requires clarity. Big moment for the Australian. The man from Hobart, Dan, the van man, they call him. They call him that because he camps out in a van lot while he pursues his dream.
Just 25 years of age, so he's one of the younger paddlers in this final. Watkins, give this a go now. He knows what the target is, he knows what he has to do, he knows that he needs to have a clean run here, avoid penalties, keep his momentum, keep the rhythm going. So far he's just outside Savsek's time, so he's 12 one-hundredths of a second behind at that first split. Just managed to get through that gate. Dan Watkins from Hobart in Tasmania.
Oh, he's got himself in difficulty here. Lost a lot of time, Watkins. Disaster for the Australian. He's going to have to recover. He's going to need something big now.
That's cost him several seconds.
Wow. You talk about pressure, and he has lost a lot of time there. Just sort of got stuck in no man's land, lost all momentum. What looks so promising in the space of a couple of gates. This equates to probably disaster by his own high standards, Watkins. He will live to fight another day, but this will not be his Olympic Games, unfortunately.
Driving towards the line, finishing in a time of 108.18. That has him in eighth position. A little tap of the helmet. He knows that he was going well there for the upper part of the course, but then just ran into problems and lost his momentum.
Yeah, just have a look here. Did some really, really nice things. Sometimes it's just that one stroke that you might miss, where you just might not go down far enough with that blade into the water. And that ability to just stop, to just take, or, you know, remove some of the momentum or increase the momentum, and it's all over. It's unbelievable just how much water is flowing down this course, which is there or thereabouts, 400 metres.
Dan Watkins can console himself in the fact that he's 25 years of age and he has several more Olympics ahead of him.
Yeah, there it is.
The bottom was fine as well, even though my arms were... Look, if there's anywhere else, could have researched so much quicker.
So there are our three at the moment. So interesting to hear those comments, and we talked about that, the fatigue level in the arms at the bottom of the course. And so maybe why we're seeing more errors and not as fast times as the semi-finals is the fact that the semi-finals and finals were not that far apart, and therefore that ability to flush the lactate, well, it's taken its toll.
Last paddler to go in this C1 final is Martin Thomas of France, chasing the top three of Savsek, Rohan and Tasiadis. A chance for Thomas to win gold for France again. France, of course, the winners in 2016 in the shape of Denis Gargaud. Can Thomas do likewise? Well, he's going to have to beat a time of 98.25. If he can beat 103.70, it will guarantee him a medal, Thomas. And he's a second down on Savchuk at the first split, so he's got to work really hard here now to try and make up some time if he's going to challenge for gold. Still in a good position to gain a medal if he can keep it clean between now and the finish.
Well, nation of France will be on the edges of their seat. I can see that the dozens of Frenchmen here, well, they're hoping, they're looking towards the heavens. Let's have a look at that split. What is the difference there? He's not at the moment. Is he in contention though? He's got some work to do and he's running out of time. So Savchek in the gold medal position, what is running through his mind at the moment as he watches the last of his competitors, who you'll have to say is out of contention?
Thomas is not going to threaten the goal. In fact, he's going to struggle, I think, to get a medal here at all. He's going to have to really push it in the lower part of the course. Watching on from the sidelines, Slovenia's Benjamin Savchek is going to be the Olympic champion because Thomas has already passed his time of 98.25. Thomas finishes in 104.98 for a fifth place finish. And we have an Olympic champion, and it is Benjamin Savchek of Slovenia. Lukas Rohan of the Czech Republic will take silver, and Sideris Tasiadis of Germany, the bronze. That is gold, silver, and bronze for Slovenia, the Czech Republic, and Germany.
Well, Tasiadis, you know, not the best run, but we saw what pressure, we saw what fatigue from the semi-final did, and he hung tough. And so that is a remarkable performance to win that bronze medal. And then you can sort of also say the same thing about silver. And the moral of the story is you just don't give up in the sport. You give 2 seconds up, but you've got to maintain your concentration. You've got to put that number on the board because finals, pressure, fatigue, it is not something that you can calculate.
Absolutely.
Remarkable.
Absolutely. Yeah, for Savchek, of course, it's third time lucky, having finished in eighth position in London and sixth in Rio. Rohan, what a performance for him. The silver medal on his Olympic debut, the Czech 26-year-old. And for Tasiadis, he can add a bronze medal now to the silver medal that he won in London in 2012. Thomas, disappointment for him, just outside the medals in fifth position. But what a day for Slovenia. What a day for Benjamin Savchek.
And look at that life-changing moment, isn't it? You know, today he wakes up not knowing. Tomorrow he wakes up and he is forever Olympic champion. And what that means in terms of the rest of his life? Well, only time will tell, but you've got a sneaking feeling there will be a smile on that man's face for a long, long time to come. Hey, he etches his name in history. Congratulations, wonderful performance.
Brilliant performance from the 34-year-old.
And we talked about it, didn't we? Maybe the best place to start was in the middle. He came in here and he was the fifth paddler to go. So he started at number five.
So he had enough. He was the sixth paddler to go.
Yeah, sixth paddler to go. My apologies. So he had five other paddlers that he looked at, put a number on the board, and then said, now, you look at me. And it was enough.
And actually bearing that point out is that Savsek started sixth, Tasiadis started fifth, and Rohan started seventh. So the three medalists all started in that little middle section.
So the moral of the story is don't read too much into the semi-final to finals. I think it's fair to say when we move on to the men's K1, the women's C1, the women's K1 final tomorrow, I think if you're in that top half, you can win the gold medal.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, it'll be celebrations in the city of Ljubljana as gold goes to Slovenia and Benjamin Savsek with a fantastic time. Look at his winning margin, 98.25. Oh, that Lukas was Rohan second, and Sideris Tasiadis, the bronze medal, 103.70. But what a winning margin.
Yeah, you just talk about the perfect performance. And, you know, the gold medal, no one can ever question that. He smashed them. I mean, at this level, when you look at those times there, that was annihilation. But it wasn't so much about annihilating his competitors. He annihilated that course.
So great joy for Slovenia and for Benjamin Savsek, the Olympic champion in the men's C1 canoe slalom. The first medals of this games at the canoe slalom venue will be presented. Savsek, Rohan and Tasiadis, the recipients.
Now we saw the head of the IOC, Thomas Bach, here, and I just wonder whether he might be presenting those medals, which again would be just wonderful for the athletes. And I just, that's the great thing, isn't it? This is what the Olympics does more than any other sport. There's just that sense of nationalism and pride. It brings a country together. You've got COVID going on around the world. I mean, sometimes it can be a cruel world in which we live in. And then just these Olympic moments, the emotion that you see from the bronze, the silver and the gold medalists. And it just brings everybody together. And it provides a sense of nationalism. Look, it might last in some countries for a week, it might last for a year, it might last for 24 hours, but it is a good thing. It just reminds us of our humanity and all the good that's in the world. And I think that final summed it up. Brilliant.
It was an incredible performance by Savsek, there's no doubt about it. And the fact that he's a gold medalist at 34 years of age, I think will give succor to the likes of Dan Martin, who at 25 will know that he'll have several more opportunities. Didn't quite happen for Dan Watkins, rather, in the final here, finishing ninth.
And how often, and I've seen it a lot across a lot of different sports, sometimes you have to do an Olympic Games to understand an Olympics. I've seen a lot of athletes who turn up in sports as the number one in the world, but it's their first Olympics, and they don't perform for that reason, for whatever it might be. And then, 4 years later, hey, they deliver, they show their potential, they demonstrate why they are the number one in the world or why they were favourites 4 years ago.
Sure.
Mesdames et messieurs, la cérémonie des vainqueurs de l'épreuve de canoë et monoplace hommes.
Ladies and gentlemen, the victory ceremony for the men's canoe singles.
皆様、ただいまより男子カナディアンシングルの表彰式を行います。
Time for the medal ceremony for the men's C1 canoe slalom event. Gold going to Benjamin Savsek of Slovenia. Silver to Lukas Rohan of the Czech Republic, who looks absolutely delighted. And bronze to Sideris Tasiadis of Germany. These the first medals to be presented at the canoe slalom venue. First medal event, the men's C1, and what a dramatic one it was as well. A brilliant, brilliant gold medal winning performance from Benjamin Savsek, posting a time 98.25. Medals will be presented by a real legend in the sport of canoe slalom, Tony Estanguet, a three-time gold medalist and now an IOC member, the Frenchman, and also Narita Shokan, IOC executive member, Monsieur former Narita Olympian himself.
Membre du comité exécutif de l'ICF Olympien.
ICF executive committee member, Japan Olympian.
国際カヌー連盟執行役員、日本
And Tony Estanguet is really a legend when it comes to the sport of canoe slalom.
Medaille de bronze, Allemagne.
Bronze medalist, Germany.
So the bronze medal goes to Sideris Tasiadis. To add to his silver medal from the London Olympic Games in 2012. He was just outside the medals in Rio in 2016. So here he is, another medal for the German. This time, the colour was bronze. A proud moment for him to receive the medal from Tony Estanguet. Tasiadis, who won a bronze medal at the 2018 World Championships as well.
Silver medalist, Czech Republic.
Well, what a performance from Lukas Rohan.
Lukas Rohan.
Silver medalist in the past at the under 23 World Championships, but this is a different level. A silver medal for him at the Olympic Games at the age of 26. Fantastic performance from Rohan to secure that silver medal. and a moment he will never forget.
Gold medalist and Olympic champion, Slovenia. Benjamin Savsek.
Well, what a moment for Benjamin Savsek of Slovenia. Twice an Olympic finalist before this, and now an Olympic gold medalist. He's a gold medalist at the World Championships in 2017, six-time gold medalist at the European Championships, and now he can say that he's an Olympic champion, an Olympic gold medal, Tokyo 2020, winning by 3.71 seconds from his nearest rival, a time of 98.25. It was a phenomenal performance. And now,
ladies and
the
gentlemen,
anthem of Slovenia.
Slovenia.
皆様, スロベニア 国歌の演奏です。
What a moment for Benjamin Savsek. Peter Kauser of Slovenia was a silver medalist in the K1 event at the 2016 Games in Rio. But Savsek has gone one better for Slovenia here. Gold he'll be taking back to Ljubljana. Lukas Rohan will leave these games with a silver medal, and Tasiadis the bronze. What a day for Slovenia, what a day for Benjamin Savsek. Mightn't be a crowd at the Kasai Canoe Slalom Center due to COVID. There is a sizable crowd around the podium there of people who are involved, volunteers, judges, and athletes from countries that have been participating, backroom staff as well. So nice atmosphere down there, and a tremendous moment for these three paddlers, particularly for Benjamin Savsek. Be seeing a lot of Lukas Rohan in the years to come as well, coached by his dad Yuri at 26 years of age. A silver medal for him, and Tasiadis, who's been such a consistent performer down through the years. Really was a tremendous event, the C1, and it's only the start of it. We've plenty more to come. Tomorrow we have the women's K1 semi-finals and final. Today it's all about the men's C1, and all about Benjamin Savsek of Slovenia. Thank you.